We are your family, your proud posterity. We love and honor you with thankful hearts each day. We are your family for all eternity, and we say thanks to you for showing us the way. In measuring a life's success, remember those you helped and blessed. For all you've done, we thank the Lord above.
My name is Joseph Grassadonia, aka Kepa, K-E-P-A.
They ever even coined it or you had it in the movies, trust me.
Okay, tell me why you got the tattoo.
I got the tattoo because my father left me when I was 10 years old. And when I first started surfing as a boy, I felt that it was God's gift to me, and I felt it when I was a little boy. And I was on the cliffs and he said, Joseph, I'm called Kepa, this is my gift to you. And as a boy, I understood it. And ever since, I surfed almost every day. And it saved my life from alcohol, drugs, anger. I did have a bit of anger as a young man, but surfing beat it out of me too, you know? But it created such a brotherhood for me and such a camaraderie for me. And Fred Van Dyke was my editor. I published On Fitness magazine, and I was his editor, where him and I got together and we published and edited his, I think, his great book called 30 Years of Riding the World's Biggest Waves. And Fred was my mentor, and he was the inspiration for much of my life and my surfing and my fitness level and my health level. And by the way, I do want to say one thing, that Fred came to me in a dream Monday morning at 6 o'clock in the morning, and it was amazing. And he told me, I better be here. And I am here. Aloha. And I love you, Fred.
Towel. Gary Ostrom.
Doug Ostrom.
Chris Wilkinson.
Buddy Wilkinson.
It's Fred all over.
Aloha mai kakou. Let's try that again. Aloha mai kakou. So welcome, as Ian said, Marion Lyman Mercero. I was a student of Fred's and a colleague as well. And we have another connection in that the last time I was at a paddle out here was for Eddie Aiko. He was a fellow crew member on the Capsize Voyage. My brother Dave and I were on. And he went to go save our lives. And I was thinking about that on the way over here, how Fred, in not so dramatic a way, probably saved as many lives, if not more, than Eddie in teaching about secondary smoke and smoking. And any of you that are former students of his know that he was way ahead of the curve on that. And I remember how he taught us, you know, just not to smoke, showing us a lung and formaldehyde and and then, you know, the lung cancer lung, and then the clean lung, and made an impression. But I digress. How good it is to gather together as a loving community of family and friends to offer comfort, support, and remembrances to each other as we celebrate the life of Fred Hans van Dyke. We know how much Fred appreciated his life here in Hawaii and here at Waimea Bay, surrounded by a community of family and friends. This olelo no iao, this Hawaiian proverb, is appropriate as we begin this service. Mehelau no ke ko'olau a ke aloha, which means love is like the fingertips of the ko'olau breeze, gentle, invisible, but present nevertheless. Although we come in grief, acknowledging our loss, we know that God cares. We also come with grateful hearts, knowing that Fred's life was a blessing to us, and we rejoice in that knowledge. Let us be mindful that this is a time of thanksgiving, celebration of the life Fred shared with us, and also a celebration of the beginning of his new life in the spirit. Let us bow our heads in prayer. E kou mako o mākua I loko o kalani, e hoa no ia, e kou I noa. Our Heavenly God, you are our comfort and strength. You are the source of our lives, and now we gather in praise and celebration of Fred van Dyke's life, for which we are so very grateful. We also gather in the pain and sorrow of separation, and we ask that you comfort us in our grief. Give us strength in our weakness, especially surround Fred's family with your grace and peace. Be with Joan, Jean, Carol, Alita, Arne, and Anna, and their families, and with the many others whose friendship and love made us part of Fred's family too. Speak to our hearts in this time of remembrance, that we may recall Fred's enthusiasm, his humor, his love of the natural world and life, his joie de vivre. May your presence fill this beach, this gathering, with joy and comfort in the midst of sorrow. Amen. We have three speakers here today, and I'd like to call first on Peter Cole. Peter Cole, the younger, more handsome, Joan says.
I'd like to say it's a real honor to read this letter that my dad wrote, because I know how highly he respected Fred and loved him as a friend. So, yeah, a lot of pressure to be in his footsteps here reading this about Fred, but I'm also privileged to do it, so thank you. Sally and I are so sorry that we can't be here to share Fred's last surf session at Waimea. Fred is one of my best friends, and I'm so glad I shared so much of my life with Fred since 1949, when I first met Fred and the rest of the Van Dyke Ohana at Santa Cruz when I was a freshman at Stanford. Fred has had an unbelievable impact on my life. First, Fred lined me up with my teaching job at San Lorenzo Valley High School in Felton, across above Santa Cruz, from 1957 to 58. Due to the high regard the principal had for Fred when he was a teacher there. During that year in Santa Cruz, Fred kept telling me that I had to come to Hawaii and join him in the North Shore surf. I was real happy at Santa Cruz, as I thought there was no better surf than at Steamer Lane. But Fred was adamant that Sunset Beach was my kind of surf and far superior to Steamer Lane. So Fred arranged for me to have a job interview with Dr. John Fox, the president of Punahou. Consequently, in the fall of 1958, I moved to Oahu to teach at Punahou School. Fred was so right, Sunset Beach is much better than Steamer Lane. In 2008, Sally and I were invited to the 50th reunion of the 1958 class at San Lorenzo Valley High School. When we were there, so many asked about Fred, as he was their favorite teacher at Boulder Intermediate and Elementary School, and had been such an influence on their lives. His ex-students at Punahou have expressed similar comments about Fred as a major influence on their lives. From 1962 to 1966, Fred and I would commute separately to Punahou from the North Shore, as we both had carpools full of North Shore students. Every commute consisted of a race between us to the Punahou parking lot. You would not believe how competitive we both were, but I think we would probably. We did some crazy driving to win the race. The students would join in the fun, and thank God they didn't tell their parents about some of the things we did. However, I had a real advantage, because at Kipapa Gulch, Fred would slow down to put on his gas mask to protect himself from the impending smog and fumes. Fred was a model physical specimen. He was in the best shape of anyone I knew and took his diet and exercise very seriously. In the summer months, he free dove all the surfing sites for turtles and fish with close friends Jose Angel, Buzzy Trent, Warren Harlow, and Pat Curran. If a surfer could free dive 50 to 100 feet, then a wipeout on a 20-foot plus wave was a short and easy endeavor. Fred, I'll miss you, and mahalo for being such a good friend. Peter Cole.
So next is Bob Peters.
I do now. I'm Bob Peters' friend and teaching colleague and surfing companion of Fred. For over 50 years, our friendship has endured. You know, what impresses me to this morning is to look out here and see the multitude of people coming from every walk of life to pay tribute and their final respects to Fred. Only in Hawaii will you see this. It's beautiful. You're beautiful. I've been told that the secret of a good speech in this case is a reflection, and my remarks are going to be a reflection of our experiences with Fred. It's a reflection of the memories we harbor of the good times, and it's to have a good beginning, a good end, and to see that the two are as close together as possible, the beginning and the end. I'll try to do that. You know, I was thinking, how can I categorize Fred, because he was so good in his literary skills and writing. And I thought of this. I remember Robert Frost's poem. Do you remember this? Two roads converge in a yellow wood. I'm sorry I could not travel both. Be one traveler. Long I stood and looked down one as far as I could. No, not that one. And I took the one less traveled by. That made the difference in the world. That was Fred. He always took that road less traveled by and was successful. He was an explorer, his plain speaking, his wisdom, his zest for life, his natural curiosity, risk-taking, enthusiasm, diversity. I could go on and on, cause him to view the whole world as his school of learning. Isn't that right? He could look in a tree and find something to learn about that. He experienced learning in every situation. He never stopped asking questions. He took the road less traveled. And as you will see, his philosophy was a guiding factor that helped him to achieve his success. Big wave surfing, teaching, community service, and as an author. A true waterman, Fred was a lifeguard, swim instructor, surfer in Santa Cruz, and big wave pioneer rider on Oahu's North Shore. You know that. He was rooted in the strong-mindedness of his health and his nutrition. You've heard allusions to that, fitness and training. Fred was a respected educator at Punahou School for over 30 years. He approaches middle school students with the same directness and maturity as he did with older students and adults. A special teacher who literally changed the lives of many of his students. To him, teaching was an honor. Former students range from authors, doctors, scientists, and yes, surfers. He was approachable and low-key teaching, very low-key with Fred, as well as his good sense of humor. They were trademarks of his teaching style throughout his rewarding career at Punahou. He was known for a lot of things at Punahou, but two things I'll mention. Outside of the classroom, he was most noted for his daily jogging to school from his Tantalus home to Punahou campus. How many of you remember that were there? That's what he would do for several years. He would jog from Tantalus to Punahou. His final achievement was when he once jogged, he had coverage on this in the newspapers, from his home in North Shore, Keiki, to Tantalus. He did that all under 8 hours. An amazing feat. Born in San Francisco, he attended Lincoln High School and San Francisco State College. His love of surfing was kindled by the mentoring he received the members of the Morro Bay Surf Club in his teen years. The club guided and mentored Friend on the ins and outs of surfing. He owed so much to this group of men and surfers. A tribute to Fred's accomplishments can be seen at the Santa Cruz Surfers Hall of Fame, on display at that location. It's one of Fred's first gun boards. He was recently honored by the Morro Bay Surf Club. Club members who played a role in mentoring Fred in his early years paid a heartfelt tribute to him in the company of over 200 attendees that night. Dr. Rim Partridge of Santa Cruz, one of his mentors, said that whenever he first came to Hawaii to surf big wave, Fred was always there to mentor him. And how many of you have been mentored by Fred today? It's amazing. I know it. Look at that. I get tears. He said that when he became, Fred was there to help. Fred returned to our table, and I've never seen this before, and I don't know about Joan, but if she remembers, there were tears in his eyes that night. You remember, Joan? There were tears in Fred's eyes. We congratulate him for that honor that the club had bestowed upon him. Still with tears in his eyes, he remarked he was grateful for the club's support and their encouragement to help him become an icon Bay Boy surfer, and he thanked us for being there as well. And he looked at his wife and said, "Joan, I love you." I first met Fred in 1965. I'm going to give you some vignettes of my experiences with Fred. Some of you will be involved in some very humorous ways. In 1965 at Waimea Bay, let me explain. Beside my new position at Punahou that year as musical director at the Academy, my real passion was to someday surf Waimea Bay. The bay broke early this year, and I paddled out to the lineup to experience the drama, but not to surf. No sooner had I reached the lineup, this muscle-bound surfer paddled up to me with no uncertain terms and said something like this, "Get the hell back to shore." I think he wanted to say the effing howley, but he didn't say that. "You have no business being out here." I did. Later on the shore, the same person who chastised me earlier introduced himself as Fred Van Dyke. Fred Van Dyke. And apologized for being so forceful and speaking the way he did in the water. When I told him I was the new choral director at Punahou Academy, and Fred also being a Punahou teacher, get this, he invited me to home for dinner that night. Wow, I was in. And my friendship with Fred has lasted over 5 decades. In the ensuing years, Fred was instrumental in rescuing me twice at Waimea. And I'm sure some of you have experienced it. Let me tell you what happened, 2 occasions. I truly believe if it wasn't for Fred's action in rescuing me, the second wipeout, I wouldn't be here today. First time I hit my head, we did the Messiah at Punahou, and I came out the next day, I was just riding high, and I hit my head on the board, got a concussion. I didn't know where I was, and I saw Fred. And he saw me, and we went to each other, he put me on the board, and took me in. Took a while, I came down to earth. The second mishap occurred on January 2nd, 1981. I wiped out and fell top to bottom, wrapped around my board during the wipeout. Once again, Fred came to my rescue. The skeg severed the main vein of my right calf. I suffered from 3 broken ribs. I could hardly breathe or move. Fred was there to take me out of the lineup. Thank God it was the last wave of the set. Had it been, Aloha Peters. He took out his bathing suit drawstring and made a tourniquet around my calf. Put me on the board, paddled me towards shore. We couldn't hit the coffin corner. We drifted to the wipeout zone on the shore break, and we had to come over about a 10 to 12 foot wipeout just to get back in the shore. But Fred saved my life. Warren Harlow is here, and we were talking. We always remember the gala Halloween parties at the home of Warren and Corley. Where's Warren? Wave your hand, Warren. Right over here. Where's Warren? Warren, there he is. There's the guy. There's the guy. He had the wildest Halloween parties anywhere on the North Shore. And Fred, as the many years I attend, always would wear a white toga that would display his chest, his abs, and his biceps. Fred was at home that walk here in the study. Fred. The yearly Christmas party held at Peter and Sally Cole's home each year was by far the biggest social event on the North Shore during the Christmas holidays throughout the decades of the 70s. as director, and with Sally at the piano, we sang Christmas carols throughout the evening. After several hours of good food, beer, and wine, one night, I introduced the grand finale. It was the orchestra song in six parts. Can you imagine surfers, guys like us, knowing nothing about music, having to sing in six parts? Fred refused to sing. He said, I retired from the Catholic boys choir at my church so I can learn to serve at Morro Bay. And I won't sing this song, it's too dizzy. So I said, okay. So I took him from the trumpet, and I put him with Peter and Warren and Jim Blotto in the bass section. All that. The drum has no trouble, just double, dub, double, 5-1. And that's all he had to do. He loved it. And we performed, had a flawless performance. Continuing. Well, commuting from the North Shore, there was some allusion to that just a minute ago. In the 1960s and 70s, it was a nightmare for all of us. I lived in Mokalee, and Fred and I would carpool sometimes to Punahou whenever our schedules permitted. When the traffic backed up at Crestview, those of you that have done that, you know how that used to back up, and the only way through the corridor was Kamehameha Highway. Fred discovered that there was a dirt cane haul road running behind Pearl City. So one of our mornings, we were driving with Fred, and he said, oh, there's the traffic, we're going this way. And he went off down this dusty shirt. I mean, you couldn't see the car. It was so, but we made it to IA in record-breaking time. One morning we did that, and a dull security truck pulled up behind us and pulled us over. He got out, he had hardware. He says, I'm gonna have to arrest you people for trespassing. We got to get to school. We're teachers at Punahou. That was the worst thing to say. And he got on the intercom and boom, 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 boom. He came walking over soon. He said, all right, get in your car, get the hell out of here, and don't come back this way again. Pretty much like that's the way he said it. We got out of there very quickly. Fred was in community affairs. How many of you know, do you know the little recreational center, Waimea side of the fire station? Fred was the community chairman at that time, and through his efforts, they got the city to increase the parking at Schwartz Cove and build that little structure. I was there for the ceremony. He gave a rousing speech. Now, get this. The air quality wasn't the best, as explained earlier. I have to add to this driving down Kamehameha Highway going to work. He would wear a gas mask, activated charcoal mask. And people, can you imagine people walking by and looking and seeing this guy? He looked like a Martian. And one morning, this woman was just fixed on him, and she had a huge fender bender, rear ender with someone. And we just said, oh my gosh, we got out of there. I don't know, I hope she was fine. But that's the kind of excitement that he created when he wore that mask. Now, this is for something all of you to ponder. You remember Jose Angel, wonderful, probably the perfect water man in my estimation. He disappeared twice off of Lahaina diving for black coral with Ricky Gregg. The second time, he never returned. And he was going through a divorce, he was having financial problems, but we lost Jose. After that, we had the paddle out right here, and we all gathered up at Peter's home. And after a few beers, Fred kind of just got to the front of the group and he looked up at Lucky and he said, Ricky, where in the hell is Jose living in Mexico or South America? See, nobody knew, no one would believe it because there was so much pressure. And Ricky just looked at him and walked away. So the rest is history. You can draw your own conclusions on that one. I've saved the best for last. I'd like to share Fred's literary success. He was the author of 5 books, and he contributed stories to many surf and health magazines, his most controversial article being in Surfer Magazine was entitled, The Latent Homosexual Tendencies of Big Wave Surfers. How many remember that? Huh? Okay. He caused bedlam in the surfing world internationally because it was in the Surfer Magazine. And many readers took the article in stride and dismissed it as a pure hype in order to boost sales and profits for the magazine. Others, however, took offense to Fred's hypothesis. For a long period of time, Fred was not the most popular person in the surfing world of Hawaii and even internationally. Fred embodies the spirit of aloha. In all this, you know, our words seem to be in vain and vacant, and our hearts are mute. Let's remember Fred for his personal generosity and his concerns for the interests of his wife, Joe Marie, his family, and friends. His passing leaves behind a legacy that in some way or other touches every one of us here today. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that Fred may rest with you from his labors, and that his spirit will touch all of us in love, passion, pain, pleasure, grief, and the promise of aloha for each and every one of us every day the sun rises for the rest of our lives. Amen. Ahui ho, Fred.
Woman who needs no introduction, Fred's beloved wife, Joan Marie.
First of all, I want to start today with gratitude. And the gratitude is for Ian Masterson for organizing this and getting all of Fred's friends and my friends all together here. And I want to particularly thank Kaleo Schneider and Gwen Ellicott, who you will enjoy the lovely food that we have for you shortly. And I want to thank the lifeguards for the tent and for the little ride out I'm going to get here, and also for making the water beautiful. That was a good job. If they could do just a little more wind, it would be really good, okay? Not to be pushy, okay? I also want to thank particularly some caregivers who have helped me with Fred in the last couple years, because they made my life and his life a lot better and a lot sweeter. And those people are Arnold Aguilar and Nofumuli Po'oi and Juanita Young and Bubbles Keahilalo Cravalo and Ma'u Finau and her cute baby. Isn't that the cutest new baby? Okay. And I want to thank all of you for being here, because you are my longest and oldest friends with Fred, and I'm so touched that you're here. And I'm not going to cry today, I hope, because, you know, this will happen to everybody. It just happens to some sooner than others, and so it's inevitable. This whole life thing is kind of not a good sign-up sheet, this University of Earth, because as soon as you're born, you start dying. It's just how long it takes you to get there. So, you know, what can I say? Well, thank you, thank you, thank you. Now, I started teaching at Punahou School in 1971. And that year, Bishop Hall was going to be demolished and we were going to move into the brand new Bishop Hall. So Punahou never lets you out of school early. One hurricane and one demolition are the only times in all the 27 years I taught there. So when they're demolishing it, they let us out so we can watch this wrecking ball, right? And here are these older teachers, the English head of the departments, and when they bust through on the third floor, they're going, "Oh, I'm so glad Fred isn't here to see this. This would break his heart." And when the wall fell away, I'm thinking, who is this guy? Because I've never seen any classroom look like this, and I just started teaching there. There were peace signs on the wall, and birds and butterflies and ladybugs and waves, you know, and it says, "Make love, not war." And I'm going, there aren't any other Punahou teachers like this. Who is this guy? So I want you to know that my husband was definitely not like all the otters in any way, shape, or form here. I met Fred at the Punahou pool. He was divorced. He had just come back from a sabbatical. All he wanted to do was get a paycheck, teach school, surf. Life could be good. So he came down with the English teacher, the head of the department, because everyone said, "Oh, she's perfect for you." He's going, no women. Don't want women. Just surf, teach school. So we met at the pool, and he says, and this is a quote from his book, that he saw me walk across the water and not around the pool, even though I had on this ugly tie-dye bathing suit. Yes. So My sweetheart was a water baby from the get-go and always, and it didn't matter if it was a swimming pool or the ocean or the waves or cold rivers or cold lakes in the mainland. We had a swimming career. So everybody, I want you to know that when I saw Fred, definitely good looking, definitely great body, definitely smart, a little too much baggage before I met him. So I'm thinking, nah, just workout partners. So we would swim in the Punahou pool, and then we would start swimming in the open ocean down by Kaimana or Ala Moana, and then we'd have a carrot juice, and then we'd go swimming, and then we'd have a cold beer. So I'm just saying, you know where that ended up, and you gotta be careful who you work out with. Okay. Now, the first time I went away with Fred, he convinced me that he was getting a new car in Portland, and I should go with him. And I'm thinking, I kind of had a boyfriend at the time, you know, and I'm going, I don't know about that, but he convinced me, and so we went. This trip took us 3 weeks to get from Portland, Oregon to San Francisco. We camped, we fished, we camped, we swam, we fished, and he didn't realize that I was a Girl Scout. So when we go camping the first time, you know, he goes out to catch trout because he wants to impress me with his prowess in catching fish, right? So while he's fishing, you know, I gather wood, I set up the fire, I put flowers on the table, I pick blackberries, and I do a whole lot of vegetables just in case he doesn't catch fish, right? Now, I want you to know this fish story here. He never told me the truth on this, and I overheard him telling somebody else this story like 10 years down the line. And I was never supposed to know, I guess, but he was trying to catch a fish and he couldn't, and he really wanted to, right? Because he wanted to look macho and, you know, Joe Camper. So anyway, he's not getting a fish. An eagle comes. An eagle swoops down, picks up this fish with its talons, and starts to fly away, but the fish is wiggling and struggling, and he drops it. And Fred runs along with his net and picks it up in the net, and he brings it back proudly to the campsite that, look what I caught for you, darling. 10 years, and I was still never supposed to know that story. Fred was one of the most generous people. He was generous with his time. He was generous with anything he knew, he would graciously teach you. He was a giver. For example, I had just given him this new Aloha shirt, and we were at some nice party somewhere, and somebody says to him, oh, I love that shirt, Fred. He took it off and gave it to him. So that's the kind of guy he was. He'd just take the shirt off his back. Rex Pershnick was a colleague at Punahou in the PE department, and Fred was his mentor as well. And I saw him at the memorial in California last week, and he told this story, which I'd kind of forgotten, that one day Fred comes home, and I look at his arm, and he always wore this silver Rolex watch, which they gave him when he retired from running the Duke meet. And you know that Rolexes are kind of pricey. So, he comes home, and I said, where's your watch? And he's got on this cheapo Seiko that's like 1995 with a plastic band. I said, where is your watch? He goes, well, it was really important to Rex, this Rolex. So I traded him. And I'm thinking, traded him? That's very interesting. And then Rex reminded me that about 8 years later, oh, and the key of that story was, he looks at me and he says, Joan, it's only time. It's only time. Rolex, Seiko, time, right? About 8 years later, Rex finally got what Fred was trying to teach him, and he gave the watch back. I thought that was kind of interesting. Now, I want you to know that Fred has always been not quite like all the others. Even in St. Anne's Grammar School with his best friends, Helmo and Dave, okay? And Fred was the eldest in his family, so he didn't know about life because he's the eldest. Helmo was the last of 10 children. They sent him to St. Anne's because the mom was so burnt out being a mom, she figures, let the nuns take care of this because I'm done, right? So Helmo had the advanced knowledge of 9 older brothers and sisters, and he was a rascal himself. So I'm just going to tell you that Fred has always been sort of rascally, because the game that Helmo dreamed up is the nuns walk up and down and they check your penmanship and your posture and to make sure you're doing your work. And Helmo dreams up the game that you unzip your pants and you whip out your uli. And he who wins the game is he who can leave it out the longest as the nun is coming up and down the aisles. And one day, Helmo won big time because he got caught hanging out with the ear and the elbow to the Mother Superior principal. So he had rascally friends all along besides all of you. I was going to tell you, too, that at the time at St. Anne's, the teacher's name was Sister Mary Felicitas, of which Fred and the boys called her Sister Mary Flippitit. And they paint her as this really old, mean bag, you know, who was always on them and all. So several years ago, there's an invitation to a St. Anne's reunion. So Helmo and Dave are going to go, and they call Fred and I in Montana, and they say, oh, come on, Fred, let's go. Fred goes, no, no, no. Weather's good, fishing's good. You guys go, report back, okay? So they go to this party. 2 weeks later, we get this big brown envelope, and there's this 8x10 glossy in there. And I laughed and laughed, because Sister Mary Flippitit was supposed to be this ancient woman, right? Well, now in this picture with Helmo and Dave on either side, okay, she's wearing a navy blue suit, and she's got kind of a short, cute haircut here. She looked younger than the both of them. So much for nuns in elementary school. Fred and I built a house in Montana. It was our art project for many, many summers. I needed a vacation to recuperate from my vacation because it was a lot of work, but it was a lot of fun. And that's why we go to Montana every year, because it's cooler than it is here with the humidity, yes. And also, there's not too many trout streams here. And the one in Kauai, you've got to walk 10 miles to get to it, and the season is 2 weeks, so it's not good, not good. Fred and I were both born and raised in San Francisco. We both went to San Francisco State University, and we both still love going to San Francisco every year to see my parents and to see my sister. And it was just a weird thing, because I was just there last week, and I did all the same kind of things that we used to do, but I did them by myself. You know, the Golden Gate Park, the beach, the Golden Gate Bridge, all that. So it was just sort of weird, because some people are worthy of being missed. Now, Fred had no intention of dying. I just want you to know that. It was just sort of a freak little accident here, and I guess it was time for him to go. But he had no plan, because we were supposed to go to Yellowstone Park with my sister that next weekend, and that was the game plan. So, the night before, before I get to that, I want to say that when Fred was 40 years old, he was always ahead of his time about the cigarette smoking, about healthy diet, about exercise. But on his 40th birthday, he marked out a marathon run from Kahuku to Punahou campus, and he did it all by himself with no water and no backup support and no energy bars. And he was 40 then, and there weren't organized ones then, so he was ahead of his time. Now, when Fred was in the hospital here, I was staying with him, and I went out to the car to get my pajamas and enjoy the sunset, and I'm sitting on the ledge of the van. And on Saturday night in Bozeman Deaconess Hospital, the Ritz-Carlton of Bozeman, that there are only three cars in the parking lot. And I'm sitting there kind of watching the sky change colors, and all of a sudden, an eagle with a wingspan like this lands on the light post right by my van. I'm going, oh, that's very interesting, okay. Next morning, my sister and Fred would always run in the morning before breakfast. So it was a nice day, so my sister comes in, she goes, hey, Fred, he's in the bed. She says, get your shoes on, man, let's go. It's gonna be a really hot day, we wanna get our run in before it gets too hot, right? And so obviously he wasn't running that day. So Carol goes out and she runs long, an hour or so. And the entire time on her run, there was a red hawk that flew with her. Now, you know Fred has this affinity and relationship with nature and animals. And those of you know his Klitschko Boski seal story, I mean, Klitschko taught him where the lineup was in Santa Cruz and how to catch those waves. And Fred really did, and I mean, he loved cats, all of you know that. And he was just a real nature animal kind of person. So when Fred passed, I have to tell you this, this is sort of, it sounds a little weird, but it'll show you how amazing he was, even though he was getting close to the end. He had this little infection, and it spread all over his body, and he was struggling with that, yet he was getting better, okay? And then somehow, it was a little heart attack caused by a loose platelet, which I don't understand. And anyway, they figured, okay, they've got this breathing support thing, because you're not allowed to die in the hospital unless your wife is there. I figured that's what it really is. So when I get there, he's not looking good, and I'm going, oh no, this is not good. So anyway, my sister comes to back me up here, and we figure we just need to let him go because we can't make him better. No matter how much I had money, it wouldn't work. So they take the breathing thing out, and he doesn't breathe for 1 minute, and he doesn't breathe for 2 minutes. And at 2:45, the doctor says, get Joan. As soon as he said, get Joan, it's like Fred came up from a big Waimea wipeout. He takes three huge breaths. Everyone's going, whoa, you know? And he continued to breathe steadily and on his own with no drugs or anything from Tuesday afternoon until he passed with my hands on his face at 11:15 Sunday morning. Everyone in the hospital, he was a living legend in the hospital because everybody says, you're supposed to be gone. And he was just there. And I really think that what he was doing in that time between Tuesday and Sunday is he was visiting all of you and all the places that he dearly loved. Because I had like 20 phone calls from people here, California, East Coast, and they didn't know anything was wrong, but they said, I've been thinking about Fred so much all week long, and I just had to call you and, you know, touch base with you guys. So I think that's really, so even at the end, he did things his way and how he wanted to, and there was no need for drugs or anything. He did it in his own time. It was him and God, and so that was a good thing. So after Fred passes, and there's quiet in the room, okay, and I've been playing Hawaiian music, of course, all week for him, I was aware of the song that was playing right as he crossed over, and it was Israel singing Somewhere Over the Rainbow. I just went, this guy is good. He's very, very good, you know? And then our friend calls us from Yellowstone Park, and he says, and he was going on this bike ride, so I said, take Fred with you on the bike ride, because he dearly loves the park, especially in September. Take him with you, because you got it. So he calls me, and he didn't know that Fred passed, and this is like half an hour later, and he says, well, you know, my girlfriend ran, and I biked up to these outer geysers, and we were there catching our breath and feeling better, you know, and enjoying the view. All of a sudden, this huge eagle lands, and the geyser goes off. I'm going, oh, very interesting, very interesting. So I told Fred, don't leave me alone because I'm doing all of your jobs and you're better at them than I am and I still need coaching. So if you are going to communicate with me, which you'd better, I want you to do it not discreetly and not subtly. I want you to do it like you're dropping a bowling ball and then give me the message so I don't miss it, all right? And so he's been sending really good rainbows and rainbows on pink sunset skies, which I think are probably tricky to do. And I want you to know that today Fred is in the J'adore perfume box here, because J'adore is perfect, that I put some of his ashes in Lake Yellowstone. So a couple friends and I, we drove to the park, and I was going to put him in the river because he dearly loves the Firehole River and fishing there, but I figured rivers all connect Missouri, Mississippi. He'd end up in the Gulf of Mexico. Somehow I didn't think Fred belonged in the Gulf of Mexico. So we found this perfect spot on the lake, or so I thought it was perfect. So tourists came right then. I'm going, no, 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 no. No tourists for Fred. This is not the right spot. So we hop back in the car and we go a little bit further down the lake. And Fred and I have spent years and months camping and fishing and hiking in the park, right? I've seen everything, but I noticed this little sign that says Sand Point. And I said, that's interesting. I wonder what that is. So I go, and it's not a parking lot or anything. It's just a turnaround so you can go the other direction. But I knew it was the spot because here's his clear message. Here's a little sign that says, to beach. I'm going, okay, I see it, Fred. So Bridget and Jerry and I walk down this trail. It's like 80 degrees that day, that nice warm sunshine pine smell, that cool greenness at your feet. We cross a little stream, which he likes. And when we come out onto the beach, it's a black sand beach. I mean, I've been on that lake a million times. I never saw that black sand beach until that day. So I wade out, you know, into the water, and I toss Fred's ashes in. And I'm just sort of admiring the view, because those of you who've been to Lake Yellowstone, the view is good in every single direction. You can't miss. So I'm feeling good about this. And then Bridget says, Joan, come here. You can see Fred.
I'm going, what?
So I walk over to where she is. Well, it's a black sand beach. The water is crystal clear, and Fred's a howly boy. So you see this white arc on the black sand. And so there Fred is in the lake forever. And last Sunday, we had a paddle out at his old surf spot, Pedro Point, south of San Francisco. And I was in the boat with Dickie Keating and his wife so that I could do the ashes and the flowers. And he has the boat dock on the side, so you gotta kinda gun it to get up the wooden thing, and then the winch can help you, right? So of course there were sets of waves so that everybody who paddled out got to have some good rides on the way in, which they appreciated. But the thing that was neat about it, well, it was sort of neat, but it was kind of funny. Fred always would say, you can't be near the ocean without getting wet, right? So that last wave, as we're pulling the boat out, hits the back of the boat and splashes me in the okole, right? So now here's my girlfriend and I in the ladies' bathroom. She's drying my underwear, which I had to wear at the party, with a hairdryer, right? Thank you, Fred. Three of my longtime girlfriends from college days, we all took a ride, the three of us, down to Big Basin, the Redwood Forest, which is just north and inland a little bit from Santa Cruz. It was the first state park in California. It has some of the oldest and tallest redwood trees. And I want you to know that the mother tree is taller than the father tree there. It's 352 feet tall. And so I spread some of Fred's ashes at the base of all of these oldest trees because he dearly loved it, and they're going nowhere, and neither is he. In parting, I know you thought I'd never quit, right? I want to do a little, this is directly quoted from Once Upon Abundance, and Fred said, the beauty of living for me is to run, swim, surf, fish, ski, eat nutritious food, and move like an animal, oblivious to the beginning or the end of life. And his other quote that I will tell you, words of wisdom, keep moving, you rust out faster than you wear out. Material possessions you need less of. Less is more in material possessions. And I leave you with love more and not less. So thank you for being here. Thank you for loving my sweetheart as much as I do. Maybe I'll love him a little more. Thank you.
Joan talked a lot about Hawaii Lono, you know, signs. And she got the breeze that she asked for. And that no'io, the naughty tern, has been flying around out there, cruising. Probably Fred keeping an eye on it all. So, te pule kako, let us pray. We celebrate you in awesome wonder, dear Lord our God, when we consider all the worlds thy hands have made in this paradise of a place that we call home. A cascade of colored, coral-colored bougainvillea, the majestic night blooming Sirius in soft moonlight, trade winds gently pushing clouds across our blue skies, cool rain showers sweeping across Mauna Valley, sunsets blazing bright orange gold above the Pacific horizon at Waimea Bay, and a star-filled night fading into another dawn on our island world. Gather this community of family and friends together as a brilliant tapestry woven with jokes, stories, and memories, with honor and respect in each colorful strand, hemmed by a love that understands and forgives and is determined in its support of one another. No matter how much we talk about this time as a celebration of life, we ask you to help us deal with the pain and sorrow that comes from the loss of this one who has meant so much to so many. We thank you for all the gifts and blessings Fred shared with others. We thank you for those special qualities of his Ironman athleticism, his dedication to excellent health, his storytelling talent, his adventurous spirit, his honest, unpretentious, easygoing, kolohe way of being. Encourage these qualities to live on in those who loved him and benefited from his kindness, his courage, his generosity, and friendship. Surround his family now with your deep, abiding love. Help us all, we pray, in the midst of things we cannot understand, to believe and trust in life everlasting. Grant us grace to entrust Fred to your never-failing love. Receive him into your mercy and grant us all the determination to remember and to honor Fred by living lives worthy of his praise. Amen. Gibran said, "And what is it to cease breathing but to free the breath from its restless tides, that it may rise and expand and seek God unencumbered? Only when you drink from the river of silence shall you indeed sing. And when you have reached the mountaintop, then shall you begin to climb. And when the earth shall claim your limbs, then shall you truly dance." Friends and family, share your stories of life with Fred, remembering that a sorrow shared is half the sorrow, and a joy shared is twice the joy. Speak for his silence, continue his legacy. Bless the breath of life, sing of a deep and enduring love, and travel with courage through the adventure of life. Weave a tapestry of peace and aloha. Amen. So we remember that God breathed over the waters of creation. God nurtured us in the waters of our mother's womb, so it feels appropriate to return Fred's ashes and honor his presence in our lives to the nurturing womb of the sea in this place of beauty and peace. Peaceful today, but also a place of amazing power and playful energy. So, with faith in your great mercy, dear God, and wisdom, we entrust Fred Van Dyke to your eternal care. Husband, father, grandfather, and friend, now we will lovingly commit his body to the sea which you created, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. We know his spirit is with you. Give rest, O Christ, to thy servant with thy saints, where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing, but life everlasting. The Lord bless him and keep him. The Lord make his face to shine upon him and be gracious unto him. The Lord lift up his countenance upon him and give him peace. He kolumea nui maka ho nua a kamana o ia a kamana o lana a me ke aloha ke aloha ka oia'e po mai ka ina mea a pau. There are three great things on this earth: faith, hope, and love. The greatest of these is love, and all things are blessed.
We'll be going out just towards the lineup side, just by the point. What we want to ask is that if you're bringing a lei out, to please make sure that you break the string and bring the string back to shore with us, because Fred would want us to save the turtles and the dolphins and the whales. And so we'll say a few short words out there in our circle, and Joni will help Fred catch his last wave. So, is that good? We'll take a few minutes to change if you need to change, and we'll meet up at the beach down there. You can see the the jet ski by the shoreline. We'll paddle out right.
This is a song that my mother and dad composed for this place known as Pupukea. Hello, Holly Waiho. La e la e o ke kai, malo o ke kai ala. Aloha au iu kame, ke kaha kai o Pupukea. The song says that the sea is calm today. It is the day of the low tide. And we love you from mountain to the seaside.
Shared with me, it's a living history, and it comes through each of you and all of the cohorts of Fred's to all of us, the future generations. Fred's legacy, all of your legacy. So thank you. The one other thing that I want to share with you is my favorite, one of my, well, Waimea Bay happens to be one of my favorite surfing sites, along with Laniakea, and I love that they pioneered that break. Fred Van Dyke with a group of people and John Severson taking the photos went down there and surfed Laniakea, and I talked to him about that, said how much I love riding an old single fin across the line up at Waimea, or at Laniakea. And he got this big smile on his face. He lit up and he looked at me. He says, "Ah, Laniakea, stay high and drive." And that was his kuleana to me. And so gotten a lot of double barrels because of that. Thank you, Fred. I love you and I miss you. Thank you, Joan Marie, for letting us share this time with her.
Towering surfer, now young men rise to challenge waves. These, your legacy. Thank you.
I think what I learned in science class was the more valuable lesson, and that is that the meaning of life is love. So thanks, Fred.
And a master of storytelling, a master of aphorisms, a seamless teacher. A couple of phrases and things he taught me. Hey, Tom, It's better to wear out than rust out. Thank you, Fred. B, when I was not having a particularly good day, Tom, you've got a bean up your ass. I want to tell you, Joan, that I finally got to say something back to Fred that he said to me. First of all, your romance with him was the romance of the century, and he loved you more than anything. I was there at the beginning, virtually at the beginning, and all the way through. The summer that you went on somewhere in one of your sabbaticals, 1981, he was with me in Lanikai, and he was not a happy guy. He was a very unhappy guy, Joan. It was all, I took him to flight attendant parties. I'm a flight attendant for United. He regaled everybody with his storytelling, but he was a crab. He needed Joan, and I don't think they've spent that much time apart ever since. So finally, that summer, I got to tell him, Fred, you got to bean up your ass.
Squeeze me. Anyway, hello, everybody. My name's Skill Johnson, and Joan, I got just 1 minute, please, and thank you so much for what you said and all those fun stories. And the one true thing, 3 points about Fred Van Dyke. First of all, before I get started, I used to live in Fred's property for 5 years way back in the 70s, which was unique. Living near also Jeff Johnson and Flippy Hoffman. God bless those three gentlemen. Giving the shirt off your back, 100% true. It didn't matter if it was a shirt, shoes, tools, anything. He taught me true aloha. I appreciate that. Number two, mahi-mahi with almond flakes on top of it. With lemon, unbelievable. Always remember that from Fred. And Fred, with one more thing, is to be yourself and true to yourself and always be honest and share. And he taught me that because he was never afraid to wear pink. I started doing that too, that was. And I say aloha to Fred and aloha to all of you and love to all. Mahalo.
And let's see, this shirt I wore it's Jose's when he was in three of the Duke Hanamoku's, the Fred starting this. And this shirt says 1969, Duke Hanamoku Surf Club Hawaii, Jose Angel. And on the back is the Hawaiian shield and Duke Hanamoku Surfing Class in Hawaii. So far, I've been surfing since 1948. You had no way to get your board except swim for it, and that made a different class of people, right? So if you want to call yourself a surfer, I think you're going to have to say you were surfing before the leashes, because when I go out now surfing, or I did go out a few up till lately, the surf is different when you have a leash. Because you know what? You don't have to swim to the shore. Find your board and paddle out. And that means you can stay out all day with a leash. And you, if you're good, you can stay out all day without a leash.
See you later.
But that separates the men from the boys and the women from the girls.
Measuring a life's success, remember those you have.